రెస్పాండ్ అవ్వట్లేదు.
సార్ టెల్ మీ సార్ యువర్ ఆడిబుల్
మేడం
టెల్ మీ సార్
కాదు, ఆహా వాళ్ళు మాట్లాడేదిగా నాకు వినపడదు, ఓన్లీ నేను చెప్పుకుంటా ఒకడే. ఇది ఓన్లీ ఈ మైక్ అంటే వాళ్ళు మాట్లాడేది వినరాదు నాకు. అదే తిప్పు తిప్పు తిప్పు. ఇది ఓన్లీ చెప్పుకుంటే వెళ్ళిపోవుడే
కాదు, ఇది అసలైంది ఓన్లీ కంప్యూటర్స్ కి మైక్ ఇన్ మైక్
కాని 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 ఇప్పుడు ఓకే. రైట్ రైట్ నాన్న. నాన్న ఫ్యాన్ అయ్యి this this sharing is visible amma slides.
Yes sir.
Shall we start? Madam shall we continue?
Yes sir.
Madam
sir yes sir.
okay thank you madam. In the faculty exchange program today we are meet here. Welcome to the session. And this is the Padala Tripathi Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, Government Degree College for Women, Jagithyal. Today our topic is nitrogen fixation. Last class we discussed about nitrogen cycle. In the topic of nitrogen metabolism, the unit topics related to nitrogen metabolism. Yesterday we are discussed clearly about nitrogen cycle. How many steps are involved in the nitrogen cycle amma? So nitrogen fixation, ammonification, nitrification, denitrification, these are the steps are involved in nitrogen metabolism or nitrogen cycle. So the first step, that is nitrogen fixation. So nitrogen fixation, today we are going to elaborately whether the symbiotic nitrogen or biological nitrogen fixation or abiological nitrogen fixation, free living nitrogen fixation. So today topic we are discussed. Before going to that, the role of the nitrogen in plants, not only in plants, nitrogen is major substance all living organism, which is the nitrogen is a macronutrient which is useful for the building blocks of the entire body of living organism, each and every organism. Are you heard about the term parasitic plants amma? Are you heard about the time of the name of the parasitic plants or especially related to, not parasitic but they are insectivorous plants. Are you heard? Nepenthes, Drosera, Dionaea, Utricularia. So these are the insectivorous plants. The plants depends upon the nitrogen. They are grown in the nitrogen less content soil or nitrogen deficiency soil. They are depends upon the insects for the uses of the nitrogen for building blocks of the body of different organisms. So nitrogen is a major substance in plants and next to water of all living organism, and this nitrogen is the building blocks for all the elements, all the living organism. And this nitrogen constituent elements like chlorophyll, cytochrome, alkaloids, vitamins, enzymes, and different all types of the compounds related to physiological functions of all living organism. And this nitrogen plays an important role in metabolism and growth of the living organism and growth of the plants. Even the reproduction and hereditary process, nitrogen is very, very essential. How we can say hereditary, the nitrogen is very essential? Because any in the molecular DNA or DNA structure, so nitrogen bases are the very, very important substance or important nutrient or important elements. So nitrogen bases, adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine. So these are the nitrogen bases are very important for the making of the DNA or hereditary process. Then what is the source of nitrogen? How many types of the sources nitrogen for availability of the different environment? So majorly nitrogen is a gaseous substance. So nitrogen present in atmosphere. Nitrogen present in atmosphere, this is more than 78%. More than 78% of the nitrogen present in the atmosphere. This is the largest amount, highest amount of the gas present in the atmosphere. So this is 78% of the nitrogen, and which is in molecular in state. And plant cannot utilize this form. Which form? This form, molecular state. So nitrogen molecule, N2, we can also show like this. So this is the molecular state. Our plants cannot utilize this form. Why? Because the covalent bonds of the three hydrogen bonds between two nitrogen atoms, which is very, very bind very tightly. So this nitrogen form is not utilized by our plants. And this form can utilize or modify, transform or fixation of this atmospheric nitrogen by prokaryotic living organism like some of the bacteria and some of the prokaryotic living organism like a blue green algae. They can utilize this form, and this atmospheric nitrogen of this molecular state is going to convert or fixation into the fixation in the soil of different nitrogen salts or nitrogen ions. So our plants cannot utilize this molecular state, but prokaryotic living organism like bacteria and blue green algae can able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen into soil. And the source of the nitrogen, even though along with this atmosphere, major source is atmosphere, then the nitrogen is available of the entire plants through different ions of nitrogen. That is nitrates, nitrites, ammonia. Nitrates, Amma, any doubts?
Sir, unable to see the slide, sir.
Oh, sorry. Now?
Yes, sir.
It is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I will tell you whenever move for next slide. Okay, this role of nitrogen in plants is visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So major substance, the nitrogen is a major substance of all plants next to the water, even though not only plants, all the living organisms, this nitrogen is major source and major element and macronutrients of the plants. The nitrogen is used as a building blocks of the entire bodies of the living organism. This nitrogen is a constant of different elements, like a constant element of different molecules are different substances like a chlorophyll, cytochromes, alkaloids, and many vitamins, and even though enzymes. So enzyme activated by different enzymes also. So this is the constant of elements in this present in chlorophyll, cytochromes, alkaloids, and many vitamins. And this our nitrogen plays an important role of physiological functions of all metabolism and growth of the plants and reproduction and hereditary. So hereditary process, we know that molecular DNA contain the nitrogen bases. The nitrogen bases are the units or the functioning unit of the important unit of the DNA molecule. And what is the source of this nitrogen? So this slide is visible, Amma. Source of nitrogen. Source of nitrogen is visible. Source of nitrogen. Sources of nitrogen. Yes, this is role of nitrogen in plants.
Yes,
visible. Okay. Next, we will move for next slide. Okay, it is visible. Sources of nitrogen.
No, sir.
Okay. Then only. Okay. Now, sources of nitrogen.
Yes, sir.
Now, okay. Sources of nitrogen. Okay. Now, so sources of nitrogen. This is visible. Yes. Yes, Amma.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So atmospheric nitrogen contains 78% of the atmosphere. The plants cannot utilize this form. Plants cannot utilize this form. Molecular nitrogen state. So 78% of the gas, highest gas percentage is present in the atmosphere, 78. This is a molecular state. So this molecular state contain between two nitrogen atoms, three hydrogen bonds, covalent bonds are very bound very tightly. So this form is unable to utilize our plants by this form. But some of the living organism like prokaryotic living organism, bacteria and blue-green algae can able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen into this site. And even though along with this atmospheric nitrogen, then nitrogen is a source from the nitrates and ammonia. So compared to this nitrates, ammonia, so nitrate is a cheap form for the availability of the nitrogen. And amino acids in the soil. So amino acids in the soil, many soil organisms use this form. Higher plants can also taken by higher plants. Higher plants can also taken by higher plants. So this is a one of the additional source of the availability of the nitrogen. Then organic nitrogenous compounds in insects. So we have already discussed about insectivorous plants. So insectivorous plants, what are the insectivorous plants, Amma? What are the insectivorous plants? Nepenthes, Drosera, Dionaea, Utricularia. So these are the four plants related to our insectivorous plants. So these insectivorous plants depends upon the nitrogen from the source of the insects, different insects. The beautiful videos are available in Google whenever you are free, or YouTube. Please watch, Amma. This slide is visible, Amma. Nitrogen fixation. This slide is visible. Next slide. Nitrogen fixation. The conversion of free nitrogen into nitrogen esterols. It is visible?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Nitrogen fixation. Now,
Yes, sir.
So, nitrogen. Okay, nitrogen fixation, the conversion of free nitrogen into nitrogen salts to make it available for absorption of plants. The conversion of free nitrogen into nitrogen salts to make it available for absorption of the plants, we can call it as nitrogen fixation. So in this, what we observed, Amma, the free nitrogen in the atmosphere, that is the molecular state, the molecular nitrogen is unable to, the molecular state of the nitrogen is unable to utilize our plants. So the nitrogen molecule is going to, the usable form, like that is the nitrogen salts like nitrates, ammonia, it is available for absorption of the plants, we can call it as nitrogen fixation. And next slide, that is it is visible, Amma? types of nitrogen fixation. Okay, so types of the nitrogen fixation. So nitrogen fixation may be by the use of living organism. So we can call it as biological nitrogen fixation, or otherwise living organism not able to involve in the fixation of the nitrogen, we can call as non-biological fixation. So biological and abiological fixation or non-biological fixation. Non-biological fixation means any living organism or no living organism involved in the fixation of the nitrogen. So whether the living organism are involved in the fixation of the nitrogen, we can call it as the biological nitrogen fixation. In this biological nitrogen fixation, some of the microbes, they are involved. Whether the bacteria or blue-green algae involved for the atmospheric nitrogen into the soil by the fixation of the nitrogen. So this biological nitrogen, again, classified into two types. They are non-symbiotic association or non-symbiotic biological nitrogen fixation and symbiotic nitrogen fixation. Non-symbiotic biological fixation means the living organism does not associate with any other living organism. The living organism freely in the atmosphere, they are fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere into the soil. Whether the symbiotic nitrogen fixation, symbiotic biological nitrogen fixation means some of the microbes, they are associated with the other plants or other environment, other living organisms. So we can call as symbiotic biological nitrogen fixation. In the symbiotic nitrogen fixation, maybe we are observed in the root nodules. So in these root nodules, bacteria, rhizobium leguminosarum bacteria is associated with root nodules. Is it right or not? Even though some of the blue-green algae, they are associated with some of the fern like Azolla anabina. Anabina belongs to blue-green algae that is associated with the fern plant. Even though some of the Nostoc is associated with Anthocera thallus, and the anabina is associated with Gymnosperms cycas, anabina cycadaceae in cycas coralloid roots. So they are the symbiotic association. They are the nitrogen fixers. They are associated with the other higher plants. Whether they are higher plants, roots, rhizosphere, we can call that as a mycorrhiza. Even though some of the fungi, they are associated with the higher plants roots. They are, we can call as the mycorrhiza. So mycorrhiza is associated with the related to this fixation. So this non-biological fixation, we can also call as this slide is visible, ma? Non-biological fixation?
No, sir.
Okay. Now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. This large ga ganapadutunda, ma? Non-biological fixation?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this non-biological fixation, we can also call as a physical nitrogen fixation. Physical nitrogen fixation, or non-biological fixation. In non-biological fixation, microorganisms do not take place. They are not involved in the fixation of the atmospheric nitrogen. But then how it's possible? The nitrogen fixation without involvement of the microorganism, the nitrogen fixation, how it's takes place? In the time of rainy season during lightning, urumulu merupulu antam chudandi, whenever the lightning, the atmospheric nitrogen is going to react with the atmospheric gas, atmospheric oxygen in the lightning process. In the lightning, they are for making of the nitric oxide. Then this nitric oxide again react with free oxygen in the atmosphere in the process of oxidation. So these are the oxidation process. In this oxidation process, so nitrogen peroxide is produced. This nitrogen peroxide, they are dissolved in the rainy water, which is formed nitrous oxide and nitric oxide. Then this nitrous oxide and nitric acid, then again are going to involve or dilute with rainy water in the process of oxidation, then again nitric acid is produced. At the same time, calcium oxide is going to react with calcium oxide, going to react with this nitric acid. This nitric acid to make a salt, that is calcium nitrate is a salt, and water molecule is released. So this is a neutralization process. One acid, one base. So this is the base and this is the acid. So one acid, one base going to react with to form a salt and a water molecule. This is a neutralization process, neutralization equation. So the calcium nitrate is salt is produced. Here we are discussing here some of the a little bit of a, one of the point we can add here. So whenever the lightening process, these nitrogen oxide, these nitric acid and nitrous acid is produced. This nitric acid and nitrous acid is going to in the process of leaching of the monuments, the beautiful monuments is going to decay or depleted of these beautiful monuments like Taj Mahal. Are you heard about the name of the Taj Mahal? Yes, sir. We know that. Yes. Taj Mahal is situated at Agra, nearby the river bank of Yamuna. Okay, river bank of Yamuna. Taj Mahal is located in Agra and nearest river bank of the Yamuna. So Yamuna river is very very nearer to the attached to the Taj Mahal. So one of the beautiful monument. So this beautiful monument is going to lose their beauty or the charming of this palarathi ani cheptunnam chudandi. So leaching process. In the leaching process, this acid is going to react with calcium oxide, can able to produce this salt, that is calcium nitrate. So this is the one of the very very important point we are discussing here. Even though this calcium nitrate is a salt, so this is a neutral process. Afterwards here the plants can able to utilize this nitric acid. They are react with the ammonia and to form ammonium nitrate. So this ammonium nitrate again combined with ammonia and to form again ammonium nitrate. So this ammonium nitrate is able to utilize our plants. So these are the usable form of the ammonium nitrate or ammonia, or even though this is a usable form of the plants of the nitrogen. So usable form of the nitrogen, it is utilized by our plants. So this is one of the method of the fixation of the nitrogen. But this is a very limiting factor. Very very a little bit content of the quantity of the nitrogen is fixation through this method, that is lightening method. That is the rainy season, whenever heavy rainy or lightening time. So this process is involved, and very very little amount of the nitrogen fixation through the biological or non-biological fixation way. Then the most important point we are discussing here, that is a biological nitrogen fixation. So biological nitrogen fixation, we can also call diazotrophy. What we can say, that diazotrophy. So this diazotrophy term has given by Gustafsson. So Gustafsson was a scientist who given and the name, that is diazotrophy. So in this diazotrophy, some of the microorganisms, they are involved in the process of the fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere into the soil. So this fixation of the atmospheric nitrogen into nitrogenous salts like nitrate, nitrites and ammonia and ammonium salts, so with the help of microorganisms, we can call it as a biological nitrogen fixation. And this biological nitrogen fixation again classified into two types, that is symbiotic nitrogen fixation and a non-symbiotic fixation. Amma, this slide is visible?
No, sir.
Or Amma, now?
Yes,
now okay, so the biological nitrogen fixation in this biological nitrogen fixation, so microorganisms, they are involved in the process of the nitrogen fixation. So this biological nitrogen fixation also we can call as diazotrophy. This diazotrophy term has given by Gustafsson, one of the eminent scientists, has given this diazotrophy. In this biological nitrogen fixation, we can again classify it into two types, whether they are associated with the plants. So we can call it symbiotic nitrogen fixation. They are the microbes, they are freely fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. We can call it non-symbiotic, biological, non-symbiotic nitrogen fixation. Okay. Now we can move for next slide. Non-symbiotic, it's visible? Non-symbiotic. Okay. Okay. This non-symbiotic nitrogen fixation means the fixation carried out by the living organism or microorganism, but in the free manner. They are not associated with any other living organism. So these are organism like a bacteria or cyanobacteria, whether they are aerobic bacteria or anaerobic bacteria or some of the blue-green bacteria, so blue-green algae. So these are involvement, they are the fixation of the atmospheric nitrogen fixation, but they are freely in the environment. They are not associated with any other living organism. Okay, so that's why this we can call as non-symbiotic nitrogen fixation. So first one is the bacteria. So bacteria is a special type of the nitrogen fixing bacteria types. So one of the free living aerobic nitrogen fixing aerobic bacteria, that is Azotobacter and Beiserinchia. Okay, then the free living anaerobic bacteria, that is Clostridium. And third one is the free living photosynthetic bacteria, that is Chlorobium and Rhodopseudomonas. And free living chemosynthetic bacteria, that is D-sulfovibro and Thiobacillus denitrificans. So these are the bacteria, they are involvement in the process of non-symbiotic nitrogen fixtures. So these are the non-symbiotic nitrogen fixtures of the bacteria, whether they are free-living aerobic, whether they are free-living anaerobic, whether they are free-living photosynthetic, whether they are free-living chemosynthetic. So these are the bacteria that are involving in the non-symbiotic way for the fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. Is it clear, Amma? Is it clear? Next. This slide is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then free living fungi. Free living fungi. Fungi. That is yeast and pilularia. Pilularia. So these are the living organisms. So yeast is this unicellular eukaryotic fungi. Unicellular eukaryotic fungi yeast, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and yeast species, and Pilularia. So these are the free living fungi. They are they are involved in the free nitrogen non-symbiotic nitrogen fixtures. And blue green algae related to cyanobacteria, or cyanophysia algae. So this blue green algae, they are maybe unicellular, they are maybe filamentous, heterocystous and non-heterocystous. They are involving in the nitrogen fixation through non-symbiotically. So this unicellular blue green algae, they are related to gliotheca and cynecococcus. So these are related to unicellular blue green alga of the non symbiotic nitrogen fixtures, and filamentous non heterocystous blue green alga, that is Oscillatoria. Then filamentous heterocystous blue green algae, that is Thalipotrix, Nostoc, Anabina. Thalipotrix, come on, tell me. Thalipotrix, Nostoc, and Anabina, right. This slide is visible, symbiotic?
Yes, sir.
Symbiotic?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then this symbiotic nitrogen fixation, this is a very, very dominating and very utilized and very useful for the fixation of the nitrogen fixation by the utilization or associated with the other living organism. The fixation of free nitrogen by microorganism in soil living symbiotically inside the plants. Living the inside the plants. So they are endosymbiosis. We can call it endosymbiotically. Okay, this symbiosis term has first coined by DeBerry. Symbiosis has coined by DeBerry. So DeBerry was a scientist who father of the who named after the father of fungi. Father of fungi, we can call as DeBerry. So the symbiosis was a term coined by DeBerry. This in the symbiotic we can also again categorize into three groups. How many groups? Three groups. One is nodular formation or nodule formation in leguminous plants and nodule formation in non-leguminous plants. And even though without produce of the nodules, that is non-nodulation formation. So these are the three categories, are three groups related to symbiotic nitrogen fixers. So we will move for next slide, Emma.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then the first one is very important, that is the nodular formation leguminous plants. Nodule formation in leguminous plants. More than 2500 species of family related to leguminaceae. They are the Caesarinatinum, Pisum, Setivum, Cazanus cajan, Arachis hyposia, and different species related to this family, they are produced root nodules. They are containing rhizobium leguminosarum bacteria, rhizobium species. And they fix the nitrogen only inside the root nodules, with endosymbiotically. In this association, what they are provides, whether the host plant provides which and the organism related to microorganism related to rhizobium leguminosarum or rhizobium species are provides. The association provides their food and shelter to bacteria. So this host plant can give the shelter, even the food for the microorganism. So host plants, they are related to leguminaceae family, whether the Caesarinatinum or Caesarinus cajan and Pisum setivum, Arachis. Okay, so these are plants can give the food and shelter to the microorganism. And then only the bacteria, afterwards, the bacteria or microorganism can supply the fixed nitrogen from the atmosphere to the usable form for the plant species. So this is the association and symbiotic association, and there are symbiotic association we are absorbed in the host plant. And even though nodules may buried in soil even after harvesting, continue nitrogen fixation by the microbes. So this is the slide. Next, we will move for next slide, Emma. Okay, this slide is visible. Okay. This nodule formation in non-leguminous plants. Nodule formation in non-leguminous plants. So before previous slide, what we explained? So nodule formation in only leguminous plants. In leguminous plants, the host plant can able to give for the food and shelter for the microbes or microorganism, and microorganism like bacteria, rhizobium species can able to give or the usable form of the nitrogen for the plants. So this nodule formation in non-leguminous plants, some other plants also produces roots in their root nodules in their roots. They are Casuarina equistifolia. Casuarina, are you heard about the term Casuarina? Casuarina. So this Casuarina equistifolia is able to produce root nodules by the help of the Frankia. So Frankia is a bacteria. So this Frankia can able to associate with this Casuarina equistifolia. And even the Frankia is able to produce root nodules in Ulnus plants, Ulnus. And Frankia can able to produce root nodules in Myrica gallei, Myrica gallei. and the rhizobium species, some of the other leguminous plants like parasponia. So this parasponia can able to produce root nodules. So these are associated associated with the symbiotically, but they are not belongs to leguminaceae family. So that's why these are the non leguminous plants can able to produce root nodules by the some of the microorganisms like Frankia and rhizobium. So Frankia can able to produce the root nodules, non-leguminous plants like Casuarina equistifolia, Ulnus and Myrica gallae. Okay, then leaf nodules, not only we are observing the root nodules, even the leaf nodules are also noted in Dioscorea and Psychotria. Dioscorea and Psychotria, these are the two species, plant species, can able to produce root leaf nodules on their leaf by this microorganism. And along with this leaf nodules, some of the gymnospermic plants like a Podocarpus and Pavetta gymnospermia and Comelia. So these are the species related to gymnosperms can able to produce nodules in their roots and leaves. So root nodules can able to produce by the Podocarpus and leaf nodules in the gymnosperms by the Pavetta gymnospermia and Comelia. So these are the produced in the nodules on the leaves by the help of the microorganisms. Okay, this slide is visible. Non-nodulation. Okay. In previous slides, what we discussed, root nodules. So nodulous formation. The nodules related to leguminous plants, that is leguminous nodulation. And non-leguminous plants also can able to produce by the Frankia in Casuarina equistifolia and Ulnus and some other plants can able to produce root nodules. They are not belongs to non-leguminous. But here in this slide, what we discussed about non-nodulation, without formation of the nodulation, they are the fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. So lichens, are you heard about the term lichens, Amma? Lichens. So these lichens, the special type of living organism, lichens are the special type of living organism of association with the fungi and algae. They are associated with the blue-green algae, can able to fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. So this is the lichen. The lichen is a term first coined by Tulane and name has given by Theophrastus. Theophrastus, lichens. So are you heard about the term bandapuvu? Farmelia, rock flower, farmelia. We can utilize, that is the farmelia, in our day to day making of the soups of the our major functions. Mana pedda pedda pandagallo ee banda puvunu use chestaru edi vanta cheyadamlo, okay na, biryani lo gaani mutton vandadam lo gaani use chestaru. So this farmelia, so farmelia related to lichens. So these lichens is associated with two living organisms, both the living organisms related to fungi and blue green algae. So this blue green algae, that is cyanobacteria, can not able to produce nodules, but they are the fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. Then anthocyras. So anthocyras belongs to bryophyta. These anthocyras we can also call as hornworts. You are already studied in your degree first semester. So these are anthocyras associated with the nostoc. Anthocyras associated with the nostoc. The nostoc related to blue green algae can able to produce the atmosphere fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. Then azolla belongs to water fern or fern plant. This is aquatic fern or hydrophytic fern. This azolla is associated with anabina. So that's why this species we can call as anabina azolle. So this aquatic fern, that is azolla, can able to grow in the paddy field of the our crop plants. And the cycas belongs to gymnosperms. So cycas belongs to gymnosperms. The cycas coralloid roots can associate with anabina cycadaceae, even though nostoc also. And along with this lichens, anthocyanins, azolines, cycas, Gunnera maniketa or Gunnera macrophylla. This nasta is associated with the Gunnera maniketa or Gunnera microphylla. And some of the other living organisms like maize, sorghum, and digitaria, these are associated with the spirillum notatum. Spirillum notatum of the bacteria is able to produce, able to fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere, but non-nodulation. They are not produce any nodules in their parts of the plants or parts of the organism. And Pospolanum notatum is associated with the Azotobacter paspali, can able to fixation of the atmospheric nitrogen. Then symbiotic nitrogen fixation. This is visible, amma? Symbiotic nitrogen fixation?
Yes, sir.
Anybody? Okay, then the in the symbiotic nitrogen fixation, we are absorbing the roots. On the roots, some of these knob-like structures or protuberances we are absorbed on the roots, so we can call as nodules or root nodules. Then the size and shapes of the root nodules are varies from each and a species. So species to species and root to root, the size and shapes are varies in the root nodules. Then the, some of they are spherical in shape, and some of the flat or finger-like protuberances we are observed, and some of the root nodules, they are elongated. And along with this, in these root nodules, we are observed from pinhead and 1 centimeter. Pinhead 1 centimeter in size, we are identified, or whenever we are absorbed in the root nodules, the size of the root nodule may be 1 centimeter, and pinhead we are observed. And the species of these various species of related to Rhizobium leguminosa or Rhizobium species, they are noted for the produce the root nodules in the leguminous plants, and named after the host plant, named after the host plants, we can say that pea plant Rhizobium leguminosarum, just because of the rhizobium associated with the leguminaceae family. So that is, we can call it Rhizobium leguminosarum in pea plant. Even the beans, we can call as Rhizobium faciolus. Why we can say that? Because the beans, the scientific name of the beans of the Faciolus manju, a manja, Faciolus mango, or Faciolus aureus. So that's why the species we can call as Rhizobium faciolus. And some of the species related to soybeans, Rhizobium japonicum. Why we can call as japonicum means the soybeans, really the species related to Japan country. So the species we can call as Rhizobium japonicum. And some of the species we can call as Rhizobium lupini. So they are associated with the lupinous plants. So these are the named after the host plants. And here, two types of the Rhizobium we are observed. Bradyrhizobium and Rhizobium. Bradyrhizobium species are very, very, very slow growing species in the entire, whether the leguminaceae family. And compared to Bradyrhizobium, so Rhizobium leguminosarum, they are the rapidly, they are the widespread, they are the fast growing species in the formation of the root nodules. So that's why we are, whenever we are culturing, so Rhizobium, we are selecting Rhizobium leguminosarum for the fast growing species, for the fixation of the nitrogen from the atmosphere. Okay, now we are going to discuss about the Rhizobium. So Rhizobium is visible. This slide is visible, Rhizobium.
Yes, sir.
So this Rhizobium leguminosarum is gram negative bacteria. Why we can say that gram negative bacterium? Christian Gram is a scientist who classified into bacteria into two types, that is gram positive bacteria and gram negative bacteria, based on the staining method. Based on the staining method, Christian Gram are crystal violet color, so that is we can call as gram positive. Whether they are not observing of this crystal violet color, they are, we can call as a gram negative bacteria. These are the two classifications given by Christian Gram. So our Rhizobium leguminosarum belongs to gram negative bacteria, and these are the non-spore forming bacteria. And also this Rhizobium is a micro aerobic bacteria, which show a degree of specificity, whether they are associated with the leguminous plants, they are associated with the other plants. So that is the specificity. And these are the two partners we are observed. That is the association with the symbiotic. That is the bacteria and host. Recognized by chemical substances. The chemical substances we can call as lectins. So lectins are the phytoagglutins, and they are the proteins. They are the proteins. Carbohydrate containing plant protein we can call as lectins. So these lectins are the phytoagglutinins. Lectins are the phytoagglutinins. They are related to carbohydrate containing plant proteins. So these are the recognized by the chemical substances by the plants. Okay, now we will move for next slide. This slide is visible. Formation of the root nodules in legumes. Yeah,
yes,
so these root nodules formed due to infection of the rhizobium. These root nodules formed due to infection of the rhizobium but the free living bacteria growing near root of legumes unable to fix nitrogen in free condition. Remember, my dear friends, these are not able to fixation of the nitrogen in free condition. They, whenever these rhizobium leguminous or rhizobium bacteria associated with the roots are forming up the root nodules, then only they can fix the nitrogen from the atmosphere. So this is the most important point. Here, roots of the legumes secrete some growth factors help in fast multiplication of the bacteria. Example, Physum sativum then can secrete homoserin, also carbohydrate containing protein, that is lectins, over their surface. So these are helpful for the attraction of the bacteria very easily. So these chemical substances can attract of the bacteria of the rhizobium leguminosa. This is secreted by host plant. So this homoserin or carbohydrate containing lectin proteins are secreted by the host plants for the attraction of the microorganisms. Then this helps in recognition and attachment of rhizobia cells. Then the this slide is visible? No. Now, this helps in recognition. Okay, this is very helpful for the recognition of the attachment of the rhizobia cells. Whenever the host plant secretes the lectins, carbohydrate containing lectin proteins and some of the other chemical substances can easily recognize from the attachment of the rhizobia cells. The rhizobia cells have carbohydrate receptor on their surface. Okay, these lectins interact with the carbohydrate receptors of rhizobia cells. Rhizobia cells occur between root hairs and young root hair. Then bacteria enter the roots through soft infected root hairs. The tips are deformed and curved. Am I audible? No.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So then whenever the lectins interact with the carbohydrate receptors of the rhizobia cells occur between root hair and young root hair. So these bacteria, when enter into the roots through soft infected root hair, so tips are deformed and curved. Tips of the roots can deformed and curved. This tubular infection thread is formed in the root hair cell and bacteria enter into the roots. So this image is visible. This image is visible.
Yes, sir.
So this is the root epidermis, and this is the root hair. This is the root epidermis. So root epidermal cells. So this root epidermal cells contain hair-like structures we can call as root hairs. Whenever the root hair is produced, lectins, carbohydrate contain lectins and some of the chemical substance is easily attracted of the bacteria. So these are the group of the bacteria can in the soil, these bacteria easily attracted, very reached the surface of the root hair or rhizosphere of the root. And whenever the bacteria to deform the and curved in nature, this is we can call it infecting threat. Infecting threat. So this curved root hair, infecting threat contain the Scabia can able to enter into the root hair cell. Enter into the root hair cell. So this is we can call as tubular infected thread. The second image, next image. So whenever the curled root hair, this rhizobia leguminosarum or bacteria can able to reach the cortical region of the root or cortex region of the roots. Okay, cortical region of the roots. And whenever this bacteria is reached the cortical region, the bacteria here, the cortical region, the parenchyma region, this young nodule is able to slowly grow into the inside the root. So this formation of the root nodule, are you visible this colorful image? No. Now?
Yes, sir.
It's visible?
Yes, sir.
Amma, it's visible?
Yes, sir.
Anybody? Okay.
Yes,
so
sir.
This is a pea plant. This is a pea plant. This pea plant, the root rhizosphere, the rhizosphere region or root region, if the bacteria whenever enter into going to deform root hairs, whenever reach the root into curve, that we can call as the infecting threat or infection threat. Afterwards, the bacteria easily enter into the cortical region of the root and the produce a knob-like structure or knob-like protuberance, we can call as bacteriaids. So the bacteriaids is the globular structure inside the roots, and whenever the bacteria is grown or synthesized or divided into numerically or numerously, and the root nodule is able to grow largely. Root nodule is able to grow largely in the cortical region of the plant. So here the root nodules, whenever root nodule is produced, before the producer of the root nodules, how bacteria is reached the rhizosphere or root hair structure, and root hair is going to curved or a deformed structure, that is infecting thread. Through this infection thread, the tubular structure, number of bacteria are able to inserted or enter into the root region, that is a cortical region. This cortical region, these cells are going to divide mitotically and to form a number of structure of the bacterial cell and produce root nodules. Okay, root nodules. So this is the how root nodules are formed. We are observed here, root nodules, how they are attracted by the lectin proteins, carbohydrate contain lectins, and root hair is reached the bacteria, rhizobium leguminosarum, and infection thread is formed, that is a deformed or curved root hair. And through this tubular structure, bacteria can able to enter into the root, and the bacteriaid, the nodular globular structure we are observed, the bacteriaid contain the rhizobium leguminosarum bacteria, and nodule are looks like a globular structure or different structures outside the region of the root. Okay. So this is, then after entry, the new cell wall is formed, the tubular infection contains mucopolysaccharides where the bacteria embedded and start multiplication. It grows much and reaches the inner layer of the cortex, and the bacteria is released. It induces the cortical cells it induces the cortical cells to multiply, which results in the formation of the nodule on the multiplying host cells. Multiplying host cells. Okay, after host cells are completely filled, bacteria cells become dormant.
What happened, ma? It's completed class. Girls.
No.
It's over, no, ma?
Yes, ma'am.